Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I should say that this performance is at the behest of Professor Kathy Green of the University of Denver. And she has asked me to say everything I know in 90 minutes and keep it clear and orderly. So I'm going to attempt to do that by using this pad of paper, which I carefully filled out over the weekend, on which I put everything that I know. However, whether I can make it all clear or not remains to be seen, and it may be that by and by I will ask your help. But at least to start with, I will tell my story and see how it turns out. Now, when I got started on this business in 1960 with my friend George Rosh, I just took it as it was, a method for taking raw scores and turning them into measures. And it was useful and easy and produced pleasing results, and I was satisfied with that. But as I talked about it more and more and more, I needed more and more of a reason for doing this. And so, by and by, I got it embedded in a philosophy of science. So, and now I always try to see it from that point of view, because I like to see myself involved in a wide process, not scrutinizing a tiny thing on a desktop, the before and after of which I have no awareness of. So I start out with science is what? Exposure. All I mean by that is consciousness, awareness. However, exposure by itself doesn't add up to anything. In fact, it's gone as fast as it occurs. We have to make a point of some kind, and that leads us to observation. And so I find it very important to differentiate between exposure and observation, because it's at observation that not only science, but sanity begins. So I want to talk about that a little bit, although in a sense it has nothing to do with the Rosh model as such, or with algebra or anything like that. Observation is necessary in order to make measurements. Measurements are something we do with observations. So you might say, well, what's wrong with the observations? Why don't we just go directly from them to the analysis? Why do we need measurement in between? And I want to make a strong point of that. I hope I can make it clear to you why observation is necessary but not sufficient. And measurement, of course, can't be done without observation, but it is also necessary for analysis. And that, in fact, we don't do any analysis without doing some kind of measurement with our observations, whether it's explicit and well-controlled or just accidental and implicit. Now, after the measurements have been established, at this point, it's just one dimension, one thing at a time. Always a fiction, because nothing is one thing at a time in its fullness, but nothing to think about can be more than one thing at a time, otherwise we can't think about it clearly. So, measurement is one dimension at a time. Analysis is always more than one. It's always a comparison of two time points, of before and after, input and output, cause and effect, or a relationship between two different variables. So in a sense, you could say analysis is always multivariate, if you like to use that kind of word. But I prefer to think of it as comparisons and the analysis of process, or cause and effect. Finally, the reason for these activities, which are the machinery of science, is in order to think. And if you're a scientist, you call thinking theorizing. This elevates it to a somewhat higher plane, but I don't think there's anything of substantial difference between ordinary everyday thinking and theory. Perhaps theory is more carefully explained, made more public, and so on, but it is the same thing as thinking. And these arrows indicate the relationships between these parts. Observation leads to measurement. And measurement goes back to the observations and suggests that some of them might be improved. So there is a circle here, a spiral, hopefully evolutionary, that is going up somewheres, in which these two activities feed each other, getting smarter and smarter about the situation that they are directed towards. Then, once you have measurement, you may do some analysis with it. But there is really very little that analysis can tell you about measurement and observation. If I look at the relationship between height and nutrition. There is very little I can find out from nutrition which will show me how to measure height. And there's very little I can find out about measuring height which is going to help me with nutrition. So there isn't a feedback from analysis to measurement. That's important to realize because many statistical techniques offered to social scientists are based on the premise that somehow the analysis will tell you about the measurement. And it doesn't work. The measurement tells you about the observations in ways I hope we will become clear. But the analysis does not. The analysis takes it for granted that you've got the measurements and that they're doing what you say they're doing, and you're now looking at how they relate to each other. Theory, of course, influences thinking, as it were, influences all of these things. So that's the basic process, and the mnemonic for it is ZOMAT. Observation begins by noticing. But noticing is not enough. We have to make something of the noticing. Say, we have to point. As soon as you point at something, you are nominating it for attention. And so it has, in the Stevens vernacular, as says Stevens vernacular, nominal status. It has become something that you can point to, so you can also choose it. And the utility of pointing is to facilitate choosing, and the motivation for choice is whether the thing pointed at is pleasurable or painful. That's where it begins. Very soon it becomes useful to name what you're pointing at so that you can tell yourself and others about what is a good choice and what is not. So the language of pleasurable choosing depends ultimately on being able to name what you've pointed at. So you give it a label of some kind. The label is maybe just a word, orange. See? Well, there's lots more to this than that word. But since I've discovered that oranges are pleasurable to eat, and it's good, and I can point to them and say to myself, well, I'm going to eat one of those, and I found out it's good to eat, but if I want to tell Mike about it, it would be better to have a name for it and agree what the name points to. So we put it into language, and then it becomes recallable. This is left cortex activity now. And repeatable. That is, we can go and look for it, and a usable. And now we have the kind of the development of this. This is perceptual, this is motor, you see. Having discovered that some things are pleasurable and some things painful, we use our muscles, our cerebellum, skeletal muscles and motility to either get the pleasure or avoid the pain. And I see that at that's the theory of observation. And the important thing to realize is that it is nominal and ordinal. That is, even in the observation, there's an order. Pleasure, pain, get, avoid. That is, they don't occur separately. Stevens gives them, says there are two things, but I think in the functioning of, in neurological functioning, if you name it, you develop a choice about it. Or to put it another way, we don't spend much time naming things about which we have no choices. That's not efficient. And once we know what's pleasurable and painful, we generally move ourselves to negotiate those things. So it's nominal ordinal, and it's qualitative. There's nothing yet really numerical about it. We haven't even started to count at this point. That's observation. Now, when you get to be scientific, you enhance this term with a model, and you say observation models. This means that you're going to define a certain situation, an item or an observation that you're going to make, a scientific observation, like the gross national product of each country, or the life expectancy of each country, or how people answer a question, 2 + 3 = ? So you identify, this is the hook, you go out and hook something. Observation model is supposed to be a hook that hooks up stuff that you want. It identifies an indicative replication. Now, every one of those words is important. The pointing and naming is the identification. It's supposed to indicate something you're interested in. Some like math items would indicate math ability. Life expectancy would indicate longevity, perhaps quality of life consequences and things like that. Indicative, and it has to be repeatable. If there's only one math question, you haven't got anything. You need many questions in math that replicate the single searching idea, the line of inquiry, which is mathematics in general. And as soon as you say this, you realize that these are indicative replications, but they're only examples. They're not the thing itself. They're only samples of the thing, or examples of the thing. These define an observation format, which in its basic form looks like this. X is the data, or the observation. What you're looking for either occurred or it didn't occur. Or maybe it occurred more than that, or more than that, or more than that. You could be counting something here that you had named. Or this could be some kind of a rating scale. And each of these categories, they have two characteristics. They have to have labels of some kind, and they have an ordinal structure. So now we have something which is qualitative. It's the same as before. Qualitative, nominal, and ordinal, but it's still very concrete. It's something that happens or it doesn't happen, and after it's happened and it's not happening again. It's a piece of history. So since what we always want to know about is what's next, this is never what we want to know about. But it's the only way we can infer what we want to know about. This is the past from which we're hoping to see the present and the future. Let's forget the present for a moment. And so while it isn't what we want, it's the only way to get there. And that's a very important thing to realize. I don't want to know which questions you answered. I want to know how much math you knew. But I can only find out by asking you some questions. So I have to find a way to make that leap from what I know but don't want to what I want but can't know. That's called inference. Now, here are some examples of observation models. No and yes, very simple. I've identified a quality, and I can ask, is it there or isn't it? Or right and wrong. I have some kind of a question, and I have an answer I expect, which I call the right answer, and if it doesn't occur, whatever else occurs is called a wrong answer. There could be more than one right answer and more than one wrong answer, but basically whatever happens, I either say right or wrong. Or absent present. One step. X has two categories, but just one step. The categories are always ordered. Now here's a two-step one. Three-category two-step. Frown, non-responsive, and smile. Or a little, some, and a lot. You see? And the important thing is these are proceeding in the direction of each time. But I'm not taking any statement about how big a step it is from a smile to a non-response, or from a non-response to from a frown to a smile. Or how far it is from a little to some, or from some to a lot. Those are things that I will find out later. That's to be done later on. I want to know those things, but at this point I don't take a stand on it. All I say is that this is more than that, and this is more than that. Some is more than a little, a lot is more than some. And we can go to three steps, four categories. Strongly disagree, disagree, agree, strongly agree, a very popular one. Never, sometimes, often, always. And on and on and on. But these could also be, think of it, if you could go further, these could actually be the life expectancies for each of the 72 countries in Pedro's data, in which case they might be ordered in 72 steps. It might be that every country has a different life expectancy, and I can go from the lowest to the highest, and there are 72 distinct values for the data. However, right now I realize I don't want all 72. That's too many steps. So as we move into this, we start to realize that it isn't better to have lots and lots of steps in the data. What you want to find out is the fewest number of steps that will do the job you want. You know that if you ask a person to differentiate on a 100-point scale the sweetness of this orange, that you're going to get lots of nonsense. Now, on maybe a 5-point scale, you can get somewheres, but probably not any more than that. So you need one of the things you learn as you construct the measures from the observation models is you learn from the measure analysis how many steps in the observation model are productive. Two or three, four perhaps, usually are pretty productive. In most tasks involving human judgment, it's very hard to discover any evidence that more than four or five steps, that is five or six categories, are producing anything but noise. And fortunately, the mathematical analysis of the data allows you to discern what is noise and what is informative. So that's what those arrows going back and forth between measurement and observation were about. Now, that's the measurement will tell you how to modify your observation models so that they are more productive for you, take less time, are more accurate, provoke less confusion, and so on. An odd number of categories producing a middle, like for 3 or 5, can often be difficult because many people will pick this center thing in order not to answer the question. So you won't know whether they really mean halfway or whether they mean no dice. And that elicits from your respondents an ambiguity which you can't untangle. So in general, it's better to have an even number of categories if the categories are being addressed by a respondent so that they won't duck out by going through the middle. And it's also, by the same token, you don't want to offer them something to circle which says not applicable. Because if you're asking them questions that don't apply, then you shouldn't be asking them the questions. But if you're asking the questions and they do apply, then you shouldn't give them a chance to refuse to respond. That isn't productive. And you need to learn, in fact, if you have asked a question which people don't like to respond to, you can learn by the confusion that occurs when they respond to that item from the chaos in their responses. So you don't need to give them the non-applicable category. Measurement. If you'll remember, I guess I should put up the code word here, well, at least the middle part of it, O, M, and A. And we were just talking about how the observation model, while motivated prior to the measurement, can be informed and improved by the measurement analysis. So measurement is the yardstick. And whenever you're working with a measurement problem, don't hesitate to go back to yardsticks and make sure that the question you're asking could be answered with a yardstick. Because if it can't be answered with a yardstick, you're not going to be able to answer it. You may be able to fake it and fool people, but you won't. This is what measurement is. And if you can't make whatever you're doing to behave like a yardstick, you haven't made a measurement yet. Now, the interesting thing is, almost everything sensible can be made into yardsticks. It's amazing how many yardsticks can be made from data which people throw up their hands and say, well, this is just too many different things. I can't possibly understand this. I mean, in Pedro's case, why would you think that life expectancy, literacy rate, and gross national product would measure the same things over 72 countries? Why? And yet, his analysis shows that they can be taken to do that, and that this measuring the same thing for them is, in fact, very informative about the countries. So instead of deciding on the basis of some religion you suffer from, it's better to do the experiment and see what happens, and the analysis will tell you. And this brings up something else about measurement models. Not only do they have to be very simple and very clear, but they have to be very demanding. They should demand what you're looking for, so that if it's not there, you learn right away from the analysis, because the model objects and it says, this is not what you're looking for. Do something about it. You don't want models that are generous and permissive and just will let any old thing happen, because then you'll keep cooking garbage and you'll never know how to make a really good pot of soup. You want a tight recipe that says you only put in potatoes and onions, no shoes, no rotten fruit, and so on and so forth. That's what you want. Now, so measurement's the yardstick. Counts, observed replications. That's what it does. Exchanges the observed data X for inferred meaning, probability of X. Now that's a terrific trick here. And that's where meaning evolves. Why don't you just sit here, Mark? You can see better. You want the heat? You like my sweater? No. Okay. We have X. We want what it means. How do we get there? By constructing a probability for X to occur, which we hope will hold up in the future. If we can use our experience with X to construct probabilities of X, then perhaps later on, because of the general continuity that we've observed and experienced, things kind of stay the way that we found them as time passes, we'll be able to use the probability of X to predict what's going to happen. And for example, here, I can flip this coin on and on and on and get all kinds of heads and tails as I move along, and I will have a history of heads and tails for this coin. But when I'm going to use it to decide who gets the pie, that history is no use to me, because we're going to flip right now, Kathy and I, and see who gets the pie. Well, why would she let me do that? You see, only because she believes that the meaning of all those heads and tails are, or is, that there's a half a chance for a head and a half a chance for a tail. So when I flip it, she has just as good a chance as I do to get the pie. And you do. See? So there it is. So you can see this is a very reliable method because it helps you get what you want. So we have to bridge this gap. And the big mistake made in many of the semi-sciences is they mistake this for the measure. They mistake this for what they should be doing statistics to. And it isn't. It's all you got, but it isn't what you want. And you have to find a way to turn it into that. Just like coin flips are done. The probability theory was devised for this purpose. The Bernoullis and the others who developed these ideas 300 years ago were being hired by gamblers and traders who were sending ships out and wanted insurance to figure out how much they should gamble, or what were good gambles, or how much the insurance company should charge to insure the cargo. And they had to use the history, which was X, to forecast the future, which is the P of X, in such a way that the forecast would turn out to be useful on subsequent applications. And the basic theory we'll use is the binomial theorem. And you know the binomial theorem. Who was the originator of the binomial theorem, Mike? Do you remember? Was it?
It was Daniel Bernoulli.
Daniel Bernoulli. Oops. Well, we're very grateful to him because lots of things follow from that. You have the probability that X equals 1, and you have the probability that X equals 0, and those are the only two values. And so the expected value of X would be the sum of the two values of X, each one times X. So that would be X0 times P0 plus X1 times P1. But since that's 0, that falls out. Since that's 1, that falls out. So P, X equals 1, turns out to be the expected value of X. And by further very simple maneuvers, you learn that the variance of X, and so quite often they just remove all of this and just talk about this as the probability of X, meaning X equals 1, and the probability of X not being 1 is the difference between 1 and the probability of X. And that's the payoff of the binomial distribution. And we will use this a lot in our work, because basically X is like a binomial distribution, and our approach to X through P of X will be thanks to Daniel Bernoulli. And we'll be interested in what we expect X to be, which is its probability of occurring, and what we think the variance of that expectation is, which is the product of its probability of occurring times its probability of not occurring. So this will come up again, and that is the entire machinery out of which all the rest is built. The only difference is when X has more than two values, you use a multinomial version of this instead of the binomial. But there's nothing basically different about it. It's a little more complicated algebraically, but the idea is already there, and it's just being extended. So, we're coming down here now. We've reached this far, and this P of X must do something for us. It must define a line of inquiry which is calibrated by the agents of measurement, the questions we ask, and which will position a measure for the object we're measuring, let's say a person, on the line of inquiry. So the measurement model has got to take X and go through P of X to get B and D, calibrating the agents D to this, and locating the object B. This line has to be a yardstick. That is, it has to have equal units, and it has to have a useful origin somewhere along it. We have to put a zero on there, and we have to be able to count up equal units. And when we get done with this, we have something which is quantitative, interval, and ratio. They're the same thing. And abstract. Remember, previously, with the observation models, we said they were concrete. They're palpable, but they're over. They're obsolete. This is abstract. It's eternal, but it's not palpable. We can think it. We can make it, we can represent it. But you see, this is a representation of the idea of equal units with an origin right here. But these units are not actually equal. Anybody with a careful distance measuring device can convince anybody else that this ruler, in fact, is very uneven, if you look closely enough at it. So we realize now that the idea is perfect, but the representation is never perfect. No representation, nothing palpable is ever a perfect representation of the idea that motivates it and by which it is used. So we have to keep that in the background as we proceed. There is an asymmetry between these two things. The object can be as complicated as it wants to be. Like my height, like I'm relatively complicated, but my height is not complicated. My height is very simple. Bing, bing. These inches here are the items by which I measure my height. And if you want to make it into a test, you get this stick longer, and then you see which items I pass, those are the inches below me, and which items I fail, those are the inches above me, and where my hair is, it's not quite clear, so there's a certain amount of uncertainty in this region. And you can score me on this test, and after you decide about where the average confusion is along here, you can say, well, we'll call that Ben's height, and that will be some inches on this ruler, and then you will call that my height. But it will be a fiction produced by the construction of this device and its very careful application in a certain way. If you did it like this, I would get much taller, you see, or if you started up here, I would get shorter. So you have to be, there are rules for how you use these things, and if you don't follow the rules, you won't get useful results. So what that means is that anybody can ruin a Mercedes by driving it into the lake. But that doesn't prove it's a bad Mercedes, or that Mercedes is a bad car, that Mercedes don't work that way. And it's the same thing with, for example, a mathematics test. You can give a mathematics test in such a way as to ruin it, like put a time limit on it, which is too short, and that'll ruin it. Or print it in a language that the people who are taking it don't speak. There are a lot of ways, and that's not just a joke, because if you use very fancy English, and you give it to children who don't speak fancy English, you may not find out how much math they know, because they can't read the questions. So, and that is nearly as well watched after as you might expect it to be, but it's a little bit like measuring height this way instead of that way. So one of the things we need to work on is to make the rules for a sensible application of a measuring device as clear as possible or as obvious as possible so that we won't confuse ourselves when we get to the analysis stage and be analyzing numbers that don't work right. Somebody might still argue that why couldn't we just count the things and use that? And I would say, well, okay, here we've got two oranges. Do you care which one I give you? Why? They're just oranges. One, two, I have five of these and five of those. Could I trade five of these for five of those? Would you make the trade? Why not? Because while these are oranges, they're not what? The same size. Well, why do you care about that? Well, the oranges are never the same size. Well, so now how are we going to do business? This reveals something to you, that measurement began not in science, but in commerce. The scientists had no motivation for measurement that was natural, but the traders had a very urgent one. They wanted to make money, and they wanted people to trade with them. You can't get a trade going unless both sides think it's a fair deal, which means you have to have units that will work in that system. Bushel baskets might work, but then you got to watch out. What if they're different sizes? So weight is even better. But as we move from bushel baskets, which are semi-fiction, to weight, which is a complete fiction, we realize to get the equity essential for commerce and trade, we have to go to abstract units and to machines like this, which maintain them well enough so everybody's satisfied, you see? And it has to be both parties that are satisfied. So whatever defects the device has to have, they can't be biased or prejudicial. They can't favor one side over the other. We're leaving philosophy now and moving into something that will be soon become algebra. The measurement model, this is the machine by which yardsticks are made. It constructs and maintains, they're both important. If this yardstick was made of butter, it would be hard to maintain and it would soon be useless. Or if it was a tape measure, it might become useless after a while because being stretched and so on. So it's very important that the machine not only constructs the, but maintains it in the, I can't measure red hot coals with this because it tends to burn it up, you see, so you have to also have a sphere of application in which the maintenance is undertaken. So this doesn't mean forever and everywhere, but there is a sphere in which the device has to work. And you need to maintain it, keep track of how it's working. If I was using this and using this and using this, I might want to notice that I was wearing away the bottom. And that after a while, people were getting a little bit taller than they should because this started at 1/2 inch off the ground now instead of zero, according to this device. Okay. Stochastic. Now, here's a fancy word which you ought to put in your mind and gradually develop insight into. It constructs and maintains. Stochastic means probabilistic. Not perfect, not deterministic, but probabilistic. Stochastic. Conjoint, it means it links two different things together, like the object and the agent, the item and the person, the item and the student. There are always two things, and they have to have a conjoint relationship. And what kind of relationship must that be? Additive. If it's not additive, now that's the same as multiplicative. You could put multiplicativity here if you wished. There's no difference in practice between additivity and multiplicativity, because if you take the logs of a multiplication, you've got an addition. You take the log of a division, you've got a subtraction. Everybody know about that? Be sure you know about that, because that's very important. All this idea that there are ratio measures and interval measures is based on claiming ignorance of logarithms. But that doesn't seem intelligent to me. And the reason we stress additivity instead of multiplicativity is because we visualize additively. We visualize according to what it takes to navigate safely. And our navigation is in the space in front of us, which is a plane, by and large. And we think the dimensions in this direction and that direction are the same. And by seeing that sameness, we manage to get around without getting hurt. And so our eyes, which are our most comprehensive analytic tool, are trained to look at XY plots, where the axes are controlled in both directions, preferably the same, or at least each interval axes. If this is height and this is weight, they're not the same axes, but they at least will be uniform, interval, linear this way and linear that way. So that the changes in position in the plane defined by weight and height will be interpretable to our eyes. We don't want to plot numbers that are ratio numbers because the scale is changing all the time, and so we will misread such plots. That means that things like income, which have a ratio interpretation, namely it's better to have twice as much money than to have one more dollar, so that the what's uniform in things like income is the ratio, not the difference. Then if you're going to plot income, you take its log, so you can see what's happening. Okay, that's what the additivity means. We must also have parameter separation. That is the B and the D, the person and the item, the object and the agent, which meet, conjoin, under a stochastic model, there has to be a P somewhere here, have to combine in a linear way, as a difference in this case. And when we go to estimate these two things, the formulation of this expression must enable us to find out where this is, regardless of which items we use. We need to know how much math Kathy knows, regardless of which questions we ask her, as long as they're math questions. Otherwise, all we know is what she knows about this test. And that's not worth anything as an inference. We want to infer what she's going to know about some other tests we haven't given her, which means we have to extract from her test performance something which applies to any test like this. It cannot be limited to the test she took. When you measure my height with this thing, it's got to apply to any yardstick that you might use. I mean, when I mail this to my tailor in Hong Kong, wish I had one, and he gives me a nice suit, we assume that my yardstick and his match well enough so that the suit will fit me. Otherwise, we couldn't do business. So there has to be a separation between measuring this, obtaining a measure for this, and obtaining a measure for this. That's why I say parameter separation. This next thing is, in fact, an unavoidable and useful concomitant of that. Because if you have this, you have this. So this is really a footnote to modern statistics. That is, we would like to have something that we can do with the X's, some combination of the X's, some way to put them together, which gives us a statistic. A statistic is always a function of the data, which is sufficient. That is, it contains all of the information that the situation is claimed to have with respect to the measure that that statistic is supposed to provide. So, we are going to look for sufficient statistics, but further research into these things has shown that these are the same thing. In fact, all of this is one thing. These are just different names for one configuration. All right, here's the picture. We want a line, a ruler. Notice that all measurements you know about, whether they're heat or time, are always laid out on a line. Sometimes a line is a circle, like a clock face. But we express every measurement as though it were a yardstick, because that's the original distance. So all measures are distances. And so when we draw this line, that's not just a happy guess. I'm going back to the roots of the idea of measurement by drawing this line. And I want you to always be thinking about the yardstick. All right, here's Mike right here. Here is some question we might ask him. And what is the relationship on the line between Mike and the question? Well, there's only one relationship that comes out there. It's the distance between them. That is it. That's all we know about this. That's all we want to know. So it's B minus D that we're interested in, not B times D, and in this case, not B plus D, although we could, this is difficulty. We could call it easiness and change its sign, but we're just confusing ourselves. This is the natural way to look at it, the distance between these two. So this distance, which contains the additivity, and which contains the conjointness, the conjoint of a person and an item, has to produce a P in some way or other. Okay, we want this. What do we have? We have Mike taking the question and either getting what we call a right answer or not. And what we want to get over here to a probability which will tell us Mike's measure and will, if we want, tell us the calibration of the question we asked him, and which will be the idea or the abstract representation of this concrete experience. It will be what this means to us. And the meaning will be go through P and come out to a measure for Mike and a calibration for the item. And we need a, X is seen in terms of P. P has to be a function of B minus D, which separates B and D. That's what I'm saying down here. So here we have the data, we have its meaning, it has to be a distance, has to produce separable measures. So this is want, have, use. Now we're going to go a little further. We've got to get P of X equal to a function of B minus D. Well, we can draw a picture of what it has to look like. P of X goes from 0 to 1, and B minus D goes from minus infinity, that's a little bit over here, to plus infinity, that's a slight way up over here. And as it goes through 0 here, that's when B would equal D, because B minus D would be 0. So we've got a very long line here. In fact, nobody's actually figured out how long that is. And we've got a rather short line here, just 0 to 1. And we can see that as this gets bigger, that gets bigger. So we can draw in what this is going to have to look like. It's going to have to be this ogive, like this. And we see right away it's curved. It's not straight. That's an interesting thing, which we'll come back to. All right, how are we going to get from here to here? Well, let's start. We know that the probability Px, according to our choice of the situation, goes from never to always, or never will happen is sure to happen, 0 to 1. If we take this and divide it by the other probability so as to make odds, we know that will go from 0 to infinity. Why? Because as this goes to 1, this goes to 0. As we divide by 0, you see, as this gets smaller and smaller and smaller as this gets closer and closer to 1, so this will go all the way to plus infinity. So we've solved part of the problem right there. Now, if we take the log of this thing, when it's 1, the log is 0. As this thing goes to 0, the log goes to minus infinity. And on the other way around, the log of infinity is infinity. So we've now got it between minus infinity and plus infinity. And why not let that be the model? What could be simpler? So we'll just say this will be defined as equal to that. Here it is, log of p for a right answer over p for a wrong answer. Or we could say the log of p when x equals 1 over p when x equals 0 will be defined as the difference between the measure of person n and the difficulty of item I. Now we can solve this equation for p and I, and it'll come out like this. That is, p and I equals the exponential function of b minus t over 1 plus. That's awkward. This is really easy to see. Log odds defined as the difference. We got everything there. We got the additivity. We got the conjointness. We will soon see we've got the separation. And we got it in the simplest possible way. There is no simpler way to get this to transform to that. As a matter of fact, though, we could use much more complicated methods for doing this. We could say we require separability of parameters. What model must follow? Or we could say we require sufficiency in the statistics. What model must follow? Or we could say we require conjoint additivity. What model must follow? And in all cases, the answer is the same as this. So while we could get here by very sophisticated methods with a certain amount of algebraic deduction, we could also get here by just kind of commonsensical reasoning. Say, well, if we have to get a function for here, and we know what the limits of this is, and we know what the limits of this is, what's the quickest way, simplest way we could get from here down to here? And here we go, 1, 2, and we've done it. First we take the odds, then we take the log odds, and we got it. And this is not only the simplest answer, it's the only answer. There is no other function that's going to meet the requirements, that can meet the requirements of conjoint additivity, parameter separation, or sufficient statistics. So it's not like this is just a lucky choice. It is unique. Now, there are a lot of people in social science still struggling to have more complicated answers to this problem. And they just can't believe that it would be all right to have such a simple one. So they make it more complicated. We won't spend time today on them. You may meet them occasionally. If you do, say, let's take some data and try your method and see what happens. Because if you do, and if you cut your data in half, say, the more able people and the less able people, and try their method, you will find you get different answers, showing that their method is not independent, that their parameters are not separable. You'll also find that you don't have sufficient statistics for their parameters. So if you actually apply these more complicated methods, you discover that they, in fact, don't help you solve the problem. Properties of the model. We have found a function now for p, which is the meaning of x, in terms of b and d, which are separate measures on the same variable. This is their difference, additivity. We see additivity right in there. What about conjoint additivity? Well, if we take the lowest person and order the persons from the lowest to the highest, and we take the hardest item and order them from the hardest item to the easiest item, we will find that the probability is lowest here, and then it goes up continually along this line and in every column, and then it goes up continually in every row until it comes out here at the top. And that's a Gutmann scale, if you know what a Gutmann scale is. Perfect ordering, perfect conjoint ordering in the probabilities, not the data. The data suffers from the vicissitudes of being real, but the idea, which is the probabilities, is perfectly ordered. So we have this conjoint additivity. And if you take b minus d and do it through here, just whatever b is, this is the lowest, this is the highest. Whatever d is, this is the highest, this is the lowest. And you fill in all the b minus d's, you will find that they increase. Every column increases down, every row increases to the right. And since p is a monotonic function of b minus d, it has the same properties. So you have conjoint additivity. Parameter separation. Just call b minus d g and I. And now compare GNI with GMI. Say two different people, but the same item. Well, the item cancels, and you have the difference of the people without an item there. So this means you can compare people regardless of which item you give them. And you can do the same thing for items, and you can compare items regardless of who you try them out on. So with this very simple little grade school algebra, you can show that you have parameter separation. That is, you can separate my height from the yardstick, and you can make the yardstick without knowing you're going to use it on me. And finally, sufficient statistics. This is a little denser here, but in finding a good value for B, we use an iteration process. Here is a good guess. Here are the X's that we've collected. Here are their expectations based on this guess of B. And here is P1 minus P. We'll come back to that in a moment. And as we add this up, we find that we're adding up the X's. That is, we are producing the raw score. So as we look at this equation by which we improve the estimates of B, this is also the estimation equation for B, we see that the statistic, that is the function of X's, which operates in here, is just the sum of them, or just the good old famous raw score that everybody has always been using. So there is a very firm connection with traditional practice. Traditional practice has been doing all their statistics on the raw scores, but the raw scores have the problem of the oranges. They're counting big and little oranges and sometimes tomatoes and all kinds of things like that. So that count is out of control. It also has the problem of being like the probability. That is, this is a picture of a test. This is 0%, this is 100%. And these are the items on the test going up here equally. 1 right, 2 right, 3 right, 4 right, up to 100 right, say. But notice that the meaning of those items is changing, because a couple of right answers here are not as worth as much as one right answer out here because of the way this curve is changing. The exchange between right answers and amount of distance between B and D is gradually shifting. So if, in fact, you're up here, say, if it's a 100-item test and you're up here at about 98 items, one more right answer here is worth 3 or 4 down here. Now, you might say, well, how do you know that? It's very easy to do an experiment which doesn't involve any of this to prove that to yourself. You have two groups of people. Some of them are getting 98, 97 on the test. Some are getting 50, 51, 52. Okay, you take the people who are getting the high score, you give them a harder test. You give them a test of the same kind, hard enough so they're now at 50. And you'll discover that the average difference, that all the people who were at 97 and then 98 on the easy test, when you get them down on a harder test where they're at 50 or so, you'll find that the 97s were averaging around 48 and the 98s are averaging around 52. So you can observe the non-linearity of the raw scores produced by the boundary of them from 0 to 100% without knowing anything of the things I've been saying at all. A very simple experiment. Just shift the test and see what happens to the same people. You could even simulate that with a long test with lots of hard and easy items by taking the easy part of the test. You could take a group of people, you see how they do on the easy part of the test. Maybe you divide them up into steps on the easy part of the test. If it's 50-50, suppose you take the 50 easy items. So you say, well, let's identify the people who got 49, 47, 48, 47. Now, let's look at how they did on the hard part of the test, where they're not getting 47, 48, 49, but maybe they're getting 25, 26, 27, and that kind of thing. And you'll find they're further apart on the hard part of the test than they were on the easy part. Well, you can see right away that means that counting raw scores is like counting oranges of different sizes. And there's no need for that, since you can use this transformation to straighten it out. Now we come to the benefit of the model being very demanding. This model is real simple. It says nothing is supposed to happen here except what B does and what D does. So it's taking a very idealistic, very demanding approach to a messy reality. So you might say, well, fine, but who will believe this? How do I dare go aloft in this airplane that's got a good theory behind it, but what if it crashes? What if the wings don't work? How will I find out how things are going? Well, when you start downtown in your car and you're out on the outer drive, How do you find out if things are working all right? You pay attention to what's happening from moment to moment. You see if you're in the right lane, and if you're not quite in the right lane, correctly in the lane, you move over a little bit this way or that way. So, same thing with this. You collect a bunch of X's. Objects in, agents I, produce some observed responses. And you construct some P's to match them as closely as possible. And you choose your B's and D's through that very idealistic and demanding function for the P to bring the P's as close to the X's as possible. And then you have, in this binomial case where X just has two values, you have what you expect X to be, which is P and I, and what you think its variation around its expectation should be, which is P and I, 1 minus P and I. Now, you look at that. That's the score residual. And if you want to standardize it, you can divide the score residual by its standard deviation, the square root of its variance, so you have a standardized residual. If you have a whole matrix of these things, every time a person takes an item, you have a standardized residual for how it was for them with that item. Now, if P is doing a good job explaining X, then these should all be reasonable. Like they should be near zero, or maybe between minus 2 and plus 2, or something like that. They shouldn't be too wide, between minus 3 and plus 3. If, on the other hand, there is a moment in here when this person did something very surprising with that item, it was much too hard for them, but they got it right. Or it was much too easy for them, but they got it wrong. That's going to stick out. They're going to have a big Z. So you're not flying blind here. As long as you look at the matrix of residuals, in various ways that have to be made convenient to the eye, you will see if anything's wrong, and you will learn what to do about how, about, you will learn from the measurement analysis of your data how to improve the observation model so that it produces measures worth analyzing. You don't want to start this until you got this worked out. So as you see misfits, residuals that are too big, you go back to the observation model and you look at the item. If it's an item that seems to be doing it, you say, oh, no wonder, this is an ambiguous item, or this item is miskeyed, or this item is on the wrong topic, or whatever, and you often find that. Or if you find that a lot of these surprisingly big standardized residuals are piling up on a person, you say, what's this person doing? And maybe you find out they just filled out the fifth choice on every item, if it was a scan sheet. Or perhaps they were sick, or perhaps they got their answer sheet upside down, or something like that. But you look for events in the material which are not the ones you want there, and then you do something about it. Now, here's a little rule of thumb that you can use for this, if you're willing to look at each response. The expected value of a standardized residual is zero, because if X is the same as P, that means we've made that P has explained X as good as possible. The variance of a standardized residual is 1. So the probability of any particular X is 1 over 1 plus Z squared. It's less than that. So that's fine, because here we have a column of Z's, and here we have a column of PX's calculated according to this formula, and we see that when Z is 1 or 2, the probability of it occurring is 1/2 or 1/5. That's not so improbable. But when Z is 5, the probability of occurring is 1/26. It's becoming unlikely. It's becoming unacceptable. It's becoming, we've got to do something. 3 is the turning point. Below here, it's not improbable enough to really take exception to. But above 3, in the 4 and 5 range, you're now getting down to probabilities so low that it seems worthwhile to investigate, to diagnose, and perhaps to reject. Now, this rejection, that's not throwing away data. If your first step here is to define a variable, you're interested in the D's and the item difficulties. If some people are behaving goofy, you don't want them in there. So when you observe a person producing standardized residuals up around 4 or 5 or bigger, better to make those responses from that person blank temporarily than to keep them in there. When you get back to doing a job for that person, you can put their responses back in and figure out what to say about them. But at the point where you're constructing the yardstick, those anomalies will not help construct the yardstick. Take them out of the data. Maybe you want to take the whole person out. If the person behavior is so erratic that you're suspicious that you can't believe anything that they're doing, then take them out temporarily. But if it's just a couple of things they did, maybe it was a random error at that point, maybe they misread or something, so you can just take out that response and keep the rest of that person's behavior in. So there is an invitation at the when you're constructing the ruler to review the Z's, the standardized residuals, and to remove, make missing temporarily, the responses which are contradicting your intentions. But always look and see where it's coming from, because what if this person doesn't belong in the sample? Or what if this item doesn't belong in the test? Then you wouldn't just make the response missing, you would remove the uninvited person or the unintended item and continue your construction. Now, of course, if you have 100 items and 1,000 people, now there are then 100,000 of these things to look at. So we need devices for expediting that, and that's one of the things that Mike and I and others work on, and Kathy, how to make the residuals easier to analyze, so you don't lose the information in them, but you don't spend hours and hours looking through tables of numbers, because it's very... You need pictures of this, really, if you can get them, and we have to invent good ways to picture this kind of problem in order to pursue the best definition of a ruler. What we were talking about so far has to do with just dichotomies, x and non-x, or x equals 1 and x equals 0. But if we can talk about x equals 1 and x equals 0, we can also talk about x equals x and x minus 1. So now, instead of looking at this two-step problem, this one-step, two-category problem, we have any number of categories, but we carry this forward by just looking at an adjacent pair. So we've just gone right across here and generalized this idea. So we're no longer constrained to just two categories. There's an amusing story behind that, because it looks very simple here, but it took 20 years to reach this point. In the 1960s, when we considered rating scales, we worked with this in the 1960s. When we considered rating scales, we went through all kinds of gyrations and all kinds of complicated algebra and to try to figure out the best way to do it. Erling Anderson busted many a gut trying to work out how to do this right, and he finally got a computer program going that would take a test of as long as 9 items and as many as 20 people. But that very few data sets are that small, so it wasn't a very useful program. But in fact, it wasn't really Jeff Masters who had the insight into this about in the end of the 70s. This is all you have to do. Just think from here to here. David Andrich probably had a hand in this too. Jeff was his student in Perth. So once we've got here, we have to add one parameter to the model. We still have B and D. We now have the person, the item, and the step. And we say the log odds for step X over step X minus 1, the one just before it, shall be Billy the person minus the difficulty of the item minus the difficulty of the step. And now we have a way to measure how far it is from strongly agree, to disagree, to strongly disagree, because that will be the measure of it. So we finally found a way to get into this model what has been missing in Likert scales, where the steps are assumed to be equal. That is a way to measure how big the steps really are. And again, this takes us back from the measurement to the observation model. If we discover steps that are not increasing in difficulty, that's a way to find out that they're not worth having. So the study of this set of these, a one for every step, if there's 6 categories to respond to, there'll be 5 of these. The study of these will tell us whether the way we've chosen to break up the observation into steps is in fact productive and stable. It's not only productive of information, but it has to be stable. That is, they have to work the same from day to day and from person to person. You can't have a rating scale that gets reinterpreted once a week by the respondents. Because if that happens, it's no use to you as a device for building up measures. So you want the scale simple enough so that it will be used in the same way by most people that you give these questions to. But you want it detailed enough to bring up as much information as it will give you. You can see that one step, two steps, twice as much information. Three steps, three times as much information. So you can really improve the flow of information from your respondent to you and the construction of a measure if you add useful steps, steps that the respondent can use. But if this respondent can't use the steps you offer them, and if they can't use them in a stable way, that is the same from day to day and from person to person, then it won't be useful to you because you'll be getting confusion coming through here. You'll be asking them to make decisions which they can't maintain stably in their behavior. So even the same person will change how they use the, if you give them a 100-point scale, they will change which where they put the sweetness of the orange, maybe 5 or 10 points from day to day, from hour to hour. So that differentiation is not producing a stable flow of information. It's not worth anything to you. On the other hand, if you just had a dichotomy, sweet, not sweet, they can tell you better than that. You know that. They can certainly give you two steps, maybe three. You know, like really not sweet at all, and deliciously sweet, and maybe in between. The in-between is a little bit dangerous because they may put all the oranges in between. But you might be able to say sour, you know, oh, I guess all right, sweet enough and delicious, see? And that, maybe people could really deal with that fairly well, and so those four steps would pay off for you. But if you went to 5 or 6 or 7, you would soon find that you were asking them to make decisions which they can't make, so they make them sloppily or accidentally, and you get noise instead of information. All right, this is a brilliant idea. I think it's kind of a synthesis of David and Jeff and me coaching them on to make my life simpler. And now it's real simple. And all the papers written on how to get from here to here, from here to here, seem beside the point, although they are voluminous and really very hard to read. Now, we have this model here. When this X is intended to be the same for every person and every item, then it has no subscripts here. But in the partial credit situation, that is where each question has its own credit structure, its own rating scale, then we have to index the X to go with the item that it's the steps are describing. So this, for here, every item has its own step structure. Here, all items have the same step structure. Nowadays, Big Steps allows you to group the items, so you don't have to have every item have its same structure. If page one has one type of items, you can make that group one and have one set of steps for that set. Then when you turn the page, you get some different labels, maybe 4 points instead of six or whatever. Then you have a second group, and so on. So what you do is you look at your observation instrument. Oh, it'd be nice if you designed it too, but anyway, you look at it after somebody else has designed it, and you group the items into those that you think ought to be working the same way, and you use the groups equals control in Big Steps to indicate how the items go into the groups. They don't have to be adjacent. They can be some here, some there, some over there. And that gives you less parameters than every item having its own, but not an unrealistic effort to squeeze everything into the same structure. We used to sometimes index this also with N and let people have their own style in answering. That has not turned out to be very informative, so I no longer put that there. Now we come to Mike Lineker's great step. Again, it looks easy here, but people struggled with this problem for quite a long time, and Mike wrote a very voluminous thesis, which became a book, and here it is. This is the step. These are the steps of the story. George Roche, 1960, but 53 was when it was done. 1979, Mark Stone and I, well, we did it about 10 years earlier. The rating scale analysis, this was basically Jeff's thesis, which is 82, but was done about 78 or 79. This is Mike's thesis. I think it's 89 is its date, but when did you actually do it? In 85, 86, 87. So this is the progression. We're now over to the yellow book, and now here's Mike's model. Log of P nijkx, nijkx minus 1. Isn't that nice? Person, N. Item, I. Judge, rater, whatever. Examiner, J. Task that the person is being examined on, K. And if there's a rating scale, the step in this item, which is being used by this judge to rate this person while they're doing this task. And this is star here means that this could be I for the task, for the item, or it could be J for the judge, or it could be K for the task. However, for practical work, you really wouldn't like it to be J for the judge. If you've got judges, and every judge is making his own idiosyncratic interpretation of the rating scale, you have a mess, and you want to get hold of those judges and train them to do better. So you wouldn't want that. It's very frequently the case that you do have items with different natural and useful definitions of their category. So this is very frequently involved. And sometimes you do have tasks that precipitate different structures. But most often you'd want this to be an I to go with the item, and least often a J to go with the judge. And actually, if you were playing with these, you're in a preliminary state, really. You haven't yet defined an instrument which is ready to go to market. It's more explorations and fooling around and amazing your friends and tickling yourself. You're not really doing sound scientific work at these points. You're fooling. When you finally get these under control, the tasks and the judges, and the items with as few types of items as is really profitable, then you're getting somewhere. There's no virtue in having a lot of this stuff in here. What you'd like is to have that not there at all, if that would work. In other words, the less parameters, the better. There's nothing good about having extra parameters. It just adds to confusion. And it invites garbage, because if you have parameters, they will accept misfits, which in fact you ought to object to. You see, if you allow each judge to use the scale in his own way, you won't find out that some of those judges are crazy. At least you won't find it out so clearly. If you insist that all judges use the same scale, because that's how you define a judge, you will find out which judges won't do that. You'll try to retrain them, and if they won't retrain, you'll retire them. And it'll be a better process. It's like people who make rulers, you see. If you find out somebody who makes these inches short and these long, and you can't get him not to do it, you don't have a parameter for him and have his rulers with this extra parameter. Remember, when you have Fred's rulers, you can't, you know, these inches are only 3/4 down here, and after that it's 1 1/4. You fire Fred and hire somebody who can make inches the same length. Well, that's the same thing here. And the same thing here, these tasks are chosen to be apt for the performance that you're studying. Again, if the performance has some kind of uniform meaning, why would the tasks have different structures? You see, you're asking for trouble there. You're flirting with trouble without producing any useful progeny. And so I would say that would be promiscuous, not productive, and I would be against it. However, sometimes it is profitable to have a few different response structures, and they may need indexing, because as you change the number of categories in the response structure, you have to change this. So I think it's quite often necessary and useful to have this index to I. It's foolish to go very far with these. Would you agree, Mike? Yes, Mike is the author and father of all of this, so. And this program is facets. Up through here, we have big steps. As soon as you get into this, you can do it with big steps, but in a clumsy way, if you have facets. So if you have data where you have raters, which is becoming very prevalent now, you really need facets. And for the next 9 months, with as much help as we can get, we're going to design a new program called Big Facets. At least that'll be its temporary name till everybody gets the idea that it's big steps, but it's facets. And Big Facets will make it, we'll try to combine the best of both of these programs so as to make this easy to get at. This comes after observation and measurement have circulated enough to produce what you can demonstrate to yourself is a stable frame of reference, a stable metric frame of reference. You demonstrate it by reconstructing it, by challenging it by looking at sections in the data. You might, for example, compare the low scoring people, the frame of reference defined by the low scorers, they're the first graders, with the high scorers, the second or third graders. You might compare the girls and the boys, or the Asians and the non-Asians, or whatever, however it would work, you see. English as a second language, English not as a second language. That's called differential item functioning study, or bias. It's just common sense. You explore over what realm of application, domain of application, the test maintains its frame of reference. And the payoff there is always the frame of reference and whether it's the same or not. These various goofy statistical techniques that are advertised to do this are mostly not helpful. What you want to know is, do the items stay in the same place, or don't they? And, of course, they won't stay in exactly the same place. So what you want to know is if they move a little, does it change any of the measures? So the bottom line is, do the measures change? Does it matter to the boys whether they take the test with the girls' calibrations or the boys' calibrations? Because if it does, if the boys get different measures, then you've got an instability problem, different enough to worry you. That is, not slightly different, but substantially different. And if things don't change for the boys, well, then it's not broken, so don't fix it. Go on. This is not perfect. Nothing is perfect. You have to remember that. So the payoff always is, does it make a difference that you care about in the measures of the objects? Now, behind that is, if the item difficulties don't move around much, if you calibrate for girls and calibrate for boys and plot the two sets of calibrations together and you get a statistical identity line, they kind of cluster around the same line, then you can see that the definition of the variable is comparable under the two circumstances. So you can deduce that if you were to construct the measures, they wouldn't change. But if you're in doubt about that, construct them and take a look. The easiest thing is to say, is there a boy-girl bias in this test? Calibrated on boys, calibrated on girls, take the girls' calibrations and measure the boys, and take the boys' calibrations and measure the boys, plot boys, girls' calibrations, boys' calibrations. Same thing around girls, girls and boys. Plot the items. You got three pictures. If they look okay to you, it's okay. And if they don't, which items? Which boys? Which girls? It won't be just any old ones. It'll be somewhere. It'll be somebody. It'll be at one end or the other. It'll be fixable. So you must look at the details. The ingredients you're working with are the item difficulties and the person measures. Look at them under the various circumstances. See if it's all right. See where it's not. Figure out what to do. Do it. Do it again until the picture looks right. There's no other way to do this differential item function stuff that makes sense and that will keep your eye on the ball. You don't want significance tests. What good is that? You want to see what happens and whether it matters. Now, we're going to analysis. We've circulated through here. It might take a year or two. It might take a lot of work, a lot of analyses, a lot of data collections before you feel like you have established a domain in which this yardstick will definitely do what you claim it will do, namely maintain its measurement structure regardless of to whom it's applied or to what. So now you've got the measure. It's always one-dimensional. It's never there's no such thing as a multidimensional measurement model. What's something where you have two things that contradict each other in the same sentence?
Oxymoron.
What?
Oxymoron.
All right, oxymoron. I like that. A moron with too much oxygen. An oxymoron. Okay. It requires measures. That's what I'm saying here. And it examines relationships. Now, here is where statistics comes in. T-tests, ANOVA, regression, hierarchical linear modeling. It can get very fancy. But I urge you, before you get fancy, make some pictures. Because if you can't show yourself what you're doing with pictures, you won't understand the numerical output of these programs. You may cite them, but you won't understand them. You won't see them. You've got to see them. Make XY plots. Cause and effect. See? Before and after. In, out. Growth, decay. That's a trend plot. Always begin with XY plots so you can see where you are going. Cause and effect. You can see here that down here we don't get much. Up here we get the most. So obviously the best cause to call for is the one right here if this is something we want. If this is something we don't want, then we want to be over here. We want to avoid this, you see. So it's like drinking red wine. No, and this might be cancer, a frequency of cancer or a vulnerability to cancer. No red wine. Let's see, it's the other way around. This is immunity to cancer or resistance to cancer. No red wine, not much resistance. As it goes up more and more, maybe up to one or two glasses a day, now you get down here, and now you're becoming an alcoholic, and you've got lots of problems. Now, this is actual research that is now being published, and that is, it has to do with, not with cancer so much as with heart, our circulation function. There are chemicals in red wine that if you take them every day, up to a glass or two, actually make you less vulnerable to heart attacks and strokes than if you don't drink any red wine. But of course, if you get up to a bottle or so a day, you've got other problems. So it does, that's too much cause. A before and after, very frequently, we have some people, we do something to them, we want to know if we did anything, whether the program was any good or not. In those kinds of a plot, the identity line is very important to us, because this is the line of no change. People up here have gained from our efforts. People down here have lost. We don't want the average improvement of the treatment group. We don't want the treatment group compared to the control group as an average. We want to pair up the treatment and control people if they're different, or we want to look at the before and after person by person, plot them in here, and see who got a lot and who lost out. That's where the treatment comes in. Who's interested in group statistics for this? You want to see individual statistics. This picture shows it all to you just like that. Sorry that this is tipping away. So now here's an in-out thing. This is a little bit, this you could call this grades, and what's coming in is more and more reading instruction. And here's the result in what, how well people know how to read. So that would be a kind of an in-out type of input-output. And what you discover is that what you put in second and third grade really pays off. When you get up around fifth or sixth grade, nothing's happening anymore. And so to make any further efforts to teach reading, at least in that way, is not productive. So these input-output curves are very useful. And then we have time here. Same idea, actually. Here is time going along. Here's a measure of something that's supposed to be increasing with time. Growth curves almost always go up and then down as you get older and older and older. So, but studying curves is very difficult. The eye is not good with curves. Perhaps it's too visceral, I don't know. But in any case, a curve like this can be turned into a straight line by taking the logarithm. So when you do your arithmetic with these curves, take the logs. And if it goes down again, take the logs both ways, and you'll find that the two straight lines cross, and that that's a better estimate of where the top of this thing is than trying to look at this as a curve, because the shape of this curve is very elusive to the eye. Whereas if you can turn it into two straight lines, you have understood it. A straight line is the benchmark of insight in an XY plot. So you want to find out what function will turn this into a straight line. And it should be a function of the cause, not the effect. If you do it for the effect, you're going to have to invert the equation so that you have it so that the effect is the consequence and the cause is the function. And remember that whatever function you seek for these causes, to make them into straight lines, they're supposed to be theories about what's happening. So if it's an inscrutable, complicated algebraic equation here, it's not going to lead to any theory about what's happening. It may be amazing, but it won't be useful. So the function has to be something simple like a square root or a log, or it isn't ever going to lead to knowledge. Science is exposure, which is unavoidable unless you're dead, observation, which you can make a point of, measurement, which circulates with observation to construct a numerical system suitable for analysis and commerce, and all under the guidance of theory. Thank you.